Hey, welcome to Mountain Church. Really glad you connected with us today via our live stream. So come on in, let's worship the Lord together.
Church, can we stand together and worship? Closely and listen to you more. Thank you for being our faithful Father, worthy of praise. And you guys can have a seat at this time if you'd like, or continue to stand as we worship. sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, cover song of thy praise. Teach me some melodious song, may song my flaming tongues of love. Praise the mountain fixed and born, mountain all that I can see. is why I sing. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. You will be praised, you will be praised. With angels and saints we sing words. You will be praised, you will be praised. With angels and saints we sing, worthy are you, Lord. You will be praised, you will be praised. With angels and saints we sing, worthy. We're so amazed at the peace that we have when we sing your praise. When your praise is on our lips, Lord, our minds are in perfect peace. We know in Isaiah that your word says, his mind is stayed on perfect peace when it's on Jesus, Lord. So we set our sights on you, Lord. We know our assurance is in you. Lord, we thank you that you give us the peace that only you can give. And we find that here when we're praising your name and seeking you, seeking first your kingdom, knowing everything will be added after we seek Jesus. Lord, may we be simplified to just that, to seeking you. Can we all stand for this last one? Thank you.
Holy. Because Lord, in and of ourselves, Lord, we could never be. But Lord, you've called us holy. And so we choose to walk in that holiness. We're so thankful, Lord, that you've done the work, Lord, to accomplish making us righteous and making us holy. And so we rally together here once again this evening, Lord, just to remember you and to get our eyes upon you. Lord, anything that we brought into this place tonight or anything that's in our heart, Lord, that's keeping us from worshiping you and keeping us, Lord, from growing in grace. Lord, we just cast those things. We cast those cares at your feet tonight. Any sin, Lord, that has grabbed hold of us or we've chosen to walk in, Lord, we choose to change direction once again tonight and to turn toward you. And Lord, we desire to just be washed by the water of your word tonight. We want to continue to worship you, not just in the songs that we sing, but Lord, in the opening and the reading of the scriptures. As we submit ourselves, Lord, to you and to your word, it's an act of worship. And so here we are, Lord,
have your way in us. We pray that your Holy Spirit would move through us tonight and change us, conform us, Lord, into the image of Jesus, which looks like love. So, Lord, would you reduce us to that tonight? Would you simplify us to love? To love you, to love each other, to love our neighbors. And so we bless you and we thank you, Lord, for demonstrating what love looks like and giving your life for us, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 You guys can have a seat. And as you do, if you grab your Bibles or open up your devices to Matthew chapter 14, as we just continue our study through the Gospel of Matthew. And we're going to encounter several things tonight. I'm real excited to hear what the Spirit would speak to us through His Word as we just continue in our chapter by chapter, you know, book by book, verse by verse study through the book of Matthew. And we'll pick up here in Matthew chapter 14, verse 1, with this character by the name of Herod Antipas. And Herod Antipas, it says here, is the ruler of Galilee. Matthew chapter 14, verse 1. Herod Antipas, ruler of Galilee, he heard about Jesus because Jesus was becoming very famous in this region at the time. And there was a lot of things that were being said about him. There was a lot of fake news, and there was a lot of real news. And there was a lot of things that were being pinned on Jesus, and there was a lot of distraction, and there was just a lot going on in the community of the day. And Herod had heard about this Jesus, and he said to his advisors, "This must be John the Baptist raised from the dead. That's why he can do the miracles." And there were those in that time, just like there are today, that tried to somehow do away with the miraculous hand of God in the person of Christ. He was doing these miracles. His ministry had begun. He was doing things that were breaking the laws of physics. He was doing things that were miraculous by definition. And there were people of the day that embraced that. They saw with their own eyes the miraculous work that God was doing in Christ. God in the flesh, Jesus Christ. And then there was this other group that were continuing to say, well, you know, he must be doing that by the power of Satan. Or maybe, you know, he's a reincarnation of John the Baptist, which is kind of what Herod is holding to here. And he was brushing off the works of Jesus, saying, well, he's a reincarnation of John the Baptist. And I find that really interesting, that not a lot changes over time. There's some things that do, but there's a lot of things that just don't change. And it's interesting how mankind will embrace all kinds of things. They'll embrace miracles as long as they're not attributed to Jesus Christ. Man will embrace all kinds of things. There's horoscopes that are printed in just about every publication that you can get your hands on. And as a culture, well, it's embraced. There's, Nostradamus, a very well-known so-called prophet. And culture has no problem at all attributing, you know, prophetic miracles to him. You'll see it oftentimes on the front page, again, of different publications and such. People embrace that kind of stuff, you know. David Blaine, who's an impossible magician, does some just impossible things that are just like, what? That's just crazy. That's an amazing one, you know. And yet, he's, you know, a coveted party guest. And it's an amazing thing how we'll embrace, you know, as a society, we'll embrace just about anything except when Jesus' name is attached to it. Well, no, it couldn't be. It couldn't be Jesus actually doing a miracle. And I think that, you know, a lot of times we need to look past the perhaps just the surface of why. Why is it that you know, culture, you know, rejects any kind of miracle that Jesus has done, or rejects the word of God? And I believe wholeheartedly that it's because Satan wants to totally discredit him. The enemy is always about the business of discrediting Jesus. And so it's no shock to me anymore when I think about why culture rejects Christ, because there's an unseen enemy, you know, that's at play, just trying to constantly, you know, devalue and to cause, you know, Jesus to look like some kind of a fool. He wants nothing more than to discredit Jesus and to discredit the work that he's done in the minds of unbelievers and also in the minds of believers. And our role as disciples of Jesus, our role is to just say, Lord, I'm going to believe you. I'm going to believe your word. I'm not going to try to take your word and massage it and manipulate it and try to make it say something that it doesn't. And when your word declares that you did these miracles of healing the blind, then Lord, you healed the blind. And when you raised Lazarus up from the dead, Lord, you really did. You raised him from the dead. And when you caused the mute to speak and the deaf to hear, and you've translated my life from death to life, and you've caused me to be born again, I just believe. And it's so important as believers, as disciples of Jesus, that we're those that just believe his word and not cast doubt on it, or not, you know, take a double take at it, but just say, you know, Jesus moved in the miraculous. He was God in the flesh, and we can lay hold of everything that he ever said, everything that he ever did is absolutely true. And so our role as disciples of Jesus, we're just to obey him and to trust in him, to walk a life of obedience and to walk a life of just saying, Lord, I trust you. I trust you with my life. You've risen the dead. You've healed the lame. You've set the captive free. It's who you are, Lord, and I trust you. And because of that, I can obey you. And it's a choice that I make. It's a choice that you make. We obey him, and we don't live a life of stress about tomorrow. You know, that's a choice that we make, right? You know that. I experience that all the time. It's a continued, Lord, I need to trust you continuously, every moment of every day, because that stress is just constantly pushing in on all of us, whatever it may be, whether it's a physical issue or it's a financial issue or a relational issue, that stress is always pressing in on us. And there's this decision as disciples of, Lord, I believe you. I believe in your miraculous hand, and I trust in you. I'm not going to live my life in this state, this constant state of stress about tomorrow. Yes, I'm going to combat that. Yes, there's going to be times where I feel that stress level rising in my life. Yes, but Lord, I'm going to choose to constantly say, Lord, I'm casting that care back on you again. I'm not going to be anxious. I have to do that all the time. And I think you do too. I'm one of us here, you know, we all have to just continue to roll that thing back uphill, you know, and say, no, I'm not going to stress about that. And then it, you know, kind of comes rolling back, and I'm going to keep pushing that back to you, Lord. I'm not going to live in that world of stress, because I'm going to trust and obey. I'm going to be generous, as your word says that I ought. I'm going to be generous with what you've given me, Lord. I'm going to be careful not to be a hoarder and not to be self-consumed. And so, Lord, I'm going to live in that place of trusting you, and I'm going to live in that place of obedience, and I'm going to help out those around me. I'm going to live the life of a disciple, even if others don't believe. Even if there's others out there that are in authority, like Herod here, you know, that don't believe and are dismissing who you really are, I'm going to choose to live and respond to your Holy Spirit. You guys do know that when you chose to place your faith in Jesus Christ, that the Holy Spirit came into your life. And you're filled now with the Holy Spirit. You're empowered by the Holy Spirit. He has taken up residence now within you. And so as the Holy Spirit begins to speak to you and prompt you in one direction or another, we choose as disciples to say, I'm going to be obedient to that. I'm going to check and balance always in your word, but I'm going to be obedient to that prompting of your Holy Spirit. And when I feel that I need to speak out that word of prophecy to my brother or my sister, then I'm going to stick my neck out and I'm going to speak that. I'm going to choose that. And it requires faith, but we have faith. He's given us his faith in Ephesians chapter 2. Jesus has given us his faith, and we believe. And so we're going to walk in that faith. And so now we begin to walk in this obedience and this trust, not only to in the negative sense, in that I'm not going to live in this world of stress and anxiety and fear, but also in a positive sense, Lord, I'm going to allow your Holy Spirit to work through me. I'm going to speak that word of knowledge into that person's life. I'm going to speak that word of wisdom. I'm going to operate and function in the Holy Spirit. Not in my natural abilities, but I'm functioning now in the Holy Spirit. I'm going to begin to speak those things out. I'm going to act upon that discernment that you've given me by your Holy Spirit. I'm going to act upon those things. And that's our role as disciples, to trust and obey and to respond in faith. I'm going to pray for that individual. I'm going to do what your word says. I'm going to anoint that individual with oil and pray for them. There's nothing miraculous about oil, but oil is a point of contact that we've been instructed in the word to pray for and anoint others. I carry a little anointing oil vial on my keychain, and I use it all the time. I'll take it out and I'll just put a little oil on my face. Nothing miraculous about it, but it's that point of contact saying, Lord, I believe, and I'm just going to anoint you right now and lay hands on you with others around perhaps and just pray for God's work and healing in your life, and I'm going to believe. I'm going to believe that you're going to do the best thing, Lord. And so, yeah, we operate in that faith and we function as believers, even though those around us may dismiss the miraculous hand of God. We walk in that and we trust him and we live in that faith and we continue to walk in that obedience. And one of those things, and again, certainly not exhaustive, the things that we're talking about as far as what that looks like, but forgiving. Forgiving is probably the number one issue in the life of the believer that they struggle with. I like to not forgive. It feels really good to just hold a grudge towards that person because they're an idiot, right? And they're a jerk and they have really hurt me. And I have righteous indignation. And so I'm going to hold that, you know, that anger and that bitterness towards that person. And it feels really good in the flesh to be like, yeah. And if I happen to get the opportunity in a dark alley, you know, I'll probably act upon that. You know, it feels good to, you know, to walk in that fleshy, you know, revenge. Maybe you guys are like, no, it doesn't. No, I don't want, you know. But there's that part of the flesh, you know, if somebody's really wronged us in a really deep way. And a lot of times it's easy for us to forgive those that, you know, have done minor things in our life, but it's that one person that comes to mind right now, or those two people that come to mind that maybe you've been angry with or bitter with for, you know, years, decades perhaps. And so we struggle with that. But Jesus says, no, Jim, don't let that person have control in your life anymore. You should have long forgotten about that individual. But you keep them fresh in your mind because you continue to be angry and you won't let it go and you won't forgive. But as disciples of Jesus, we forgive. We forgive. And that doesn't mean that there aren't consequences, by the way, for the behavior of other individuals. Forgiveness isn't saying, well, we forgive and you shouldn't pay any kind of retribution for your sin. You know, that's not the idea. The idea is I forgive you. I'm not going to hold this against you. And I'm going to let God sort out what justice looks like in your life. But I'm not going to let you have control in my life any longer. It's been way, way, way too long that I've allowed you. You probably haven't even thought my name in 30 years, but I still allow you to have control of my heart by being bitter. And so we let that go. We say, no, I'm not going to walk in that bitterness any longer. Well, let's go on. It says in verse 14, or verse 3, pardon me, Matthew 14. And for Herod had arrested and imprisoned John as a favor to his wife Herodias, the former wife of Herod's brother Philip. And John had been telling Herod, it is against God's law for you to marry her. So Herod was married to this woman Herodias. Herodias used to be the wife of Herod's brother. And so Herod had ditched his wife and taken his brother's wife. And John the Baptist, as you guys know, was a pretty in-your-face, in-your-grill kind of guy. And he talked to Herod and said, hey, man, that is wrong. Time out. That is immoral. You're a king. You can't do that, man. And he called Herod out. And Herod was like, go to prison, you know. But John the Baptist, I love that he stood on the truth, you know. And, you know, when you speak the truth, and you guys know this, listen, when you speak the truth, it's dangerous. You know that? Speaking the truth is very dangerous because you're going to encounter those that don't want to hear the truth. Now, you always do that in love. We talked about that a little bit this last weekend. You always speak the truth in love. But as much as you do, you're still going to encounter those that are resistant to the truth. People that are living in sin, like Herod here, he doesn't want to hear the truth. And I don't know how John the Baptist said this exactly. He was pretty bold. But I hope he spoke it in love. But either way, Herod would have none of it. Speaking the truth is dangerous. I just received a threat again a few weeks ago. Got a voicemail, very threatening voicemail. My wife got the same threatening voicemail. Some of the pastors here got a threatening voicemail, same individual. And it was all because, well, I spoke the truth. And I try to do that in the most loving way that I can. It's not always the best. So I don't always speak it like Jesus would have spoke it. But that's my goal. Nevertheless, you guys have encountered very similar things. I know you have. You speak the truth, and man, it just riles some people up. And it's what we signed up for. You know, as believers in Jesus, when we love and when we speak the truth, there are going to be some that are just going to deny the miraculous hand of God. They're going to deny Christ, and they're going to get angry, just like Herod did. Because truth infuriates those who are living in sin. I can remember back in those days in my life over the years where truth was spoken to me, and it just burned me up, and it just ticked me off. And a lot of times it came from people that I know now really loved me, and they were willing to speak the truth. My own family, my own brother, who I'm very close with now, just had breakfast with him this morning early. But there was a time in our life where we were just like at major odds because he would speak the truth lovingly, but I would just be infuriated by that because, well, of my own personal conviction. But we just have to get used to it, you know. Living in the truth is it's somewhat of a dangerous lifestyle, but who else holds the words of eternal life but Christ? What else can we do? We can just live in the truth. And that's what we do as disciples of Jesus. Jesus always spoke the truth. He was the truth. He is the truth. And as you know, there were those all through the Gospels that were infuriated by the truth. In verse 6, Matthew chapter 14, verse 6, but at a birthday party for Herod, Herodias' daughter, it says here in verse 6, performed a dance that greatly pleased him. So he promised with a vow to give her anything that she wanted. And at her mother's urging, the girl said, I want the head of John the Baptist on a tray. And then, verse 9, note it, the king regretted what he had said. But because of the vow that he had made in front of his guests, he issued the necessary orders. So John was beheaded in prison, and his head was brought on a tray and given to the girl, who took it to her mother. So Herodias was scorned by John the Baptist, who said, hey, you and Herod, you should not be together, man. This is wrong. He was thrown in prison. Herodias was, you know, quite a bit, apparently. She was very, embarrassed by the whole situation, and this whole scandal was kind of, you know, brought to light, and so she was really angry. Her daughter dances this dance for Herod. He says, I'll give you anything you want. And then she confides with her mom, and mom says, hey, he said anything, man. And so why don't you just have him go take the head of John the Baptist and give it to you on a tray? It's interesting, the language in this denotes that this daughter of Herodias, she gave herself wholly to the dance. That's the idea, where she danced before Herod. She gave herself wholly to it. And the implication there is she danced a very seductive dance. And he watched that, and he was taken in by that, and lusted because of that, and was in a place where he's like, I'll just give you anything you want. The king was lured in by this dancing girl, and he ended up making a promise that would cost him greatly. And I wanted to stop, I want to pause for a moment and think about that particular aspect of this story where this seductive woman brings this terrible regret in the heart of Herod. He's seduced. And he ends up, as it says in verse 9, he ends up regretting what he said. See, the seductive woman ended up causing the king, not to dismiss his part in it, but causing the king to commit an act of murder. We've seen this other places in Scripture where men get involved in seductive situations and end up killing. You think of David and Bathsheba. And there's a pattern here. I've seen personally my own more than my share of marital death due to the seduction of others. Doesn't dismiss or discount falling into that or choosing to go down that road. But I would say, in light of what we see in this pattern over the whole of Scripture, listen, men, be on your guard for the seduction of women, for they are everywhere in our culture. They're everywhere. In this internet age, man, there's a deadly attraction out there that can so easily pull men in, women too, but men in general. And they'll lure you in with all kinds of craziness and all kinds of fantasy and all kinds of bizarrety. They'll lure you in and bring death. I've seen it so many times. Good people that really, really love the Lord and have chosen to compromise a little here and compromise a little there. Not unlike David when he saw Bathsheba outside of his window there. I don't, and I can't prove this because the word doesn't say it explicitly, but I don't think that was the first time he ever looked out that window. The way I read it. A little here, a little there. Oh, I got this under control. And pretty soon there's a death to joy. There's a death to family. Death to relationships, death to marriages, death to finances. It just goes on and on and on. That's what sin does. It always brings death. And you know that. But in this particular case, as we see it here in the Word, he was pulled in, and pretty soon he was like, I'll give you up to half my kingdom. And that's a lot. And then just a phrase or two later, it says he regretted what he had said. There's always regret that accompanies that. And so beware. And I know I sing this song a lot. But if you don't have some kind of accountability on your devices, on your pads, on your phones, on your MacBook, something where there's an accountability there. Some type of a program. I use what's called Safe Eyes and also Covenant Eyes. And what Covenant Eyes does is it sends a email to chosen individuals that I have an accountability with. It sends an email every week to that particular, those chosen partners, friends, of everything that's gone into my URL address. Everything. There's no way around it. It's rock solid. Why? Well, because way, way, way greater men than I have fallen. Biblically and contemporaries. Way great, godly men that I respect. And their whole world has come crashing down. Some that I've known personally, others that are just, you know, big names in the Christian world. And you know who they are too, I'm sure. It's only a matter of time before you are seduced, in a sense, in that way. It's only a matter of time. It's not a matter of if, it's a matter of when. And if you don't choose to walk in accountability, and it's a choice, and it's difficult, and it's a pain in the rear, because it's just a pain, you know, the whole thing. But if you choose not, it's only a matter of eventuality. It's going to, at some point, it's going to pull you in. And so be very careful. Be very careful. And I throw that out there once again, just as a, you know, be careful in how you navigate through this very seductive world. Men, be careful who you invest your treasures into. If you have female friends, which you should, I hope you have girl friends that are friends of yours. Man, be careful what you invest in them, emotionally and otherwise. And the same is true for the gals, you know. Guard our hearts. We need to guard our hearts and minds. Jesus said this. He said in Matthew chapter 6, if you can remember back to when we were going through that, he says, where your treasure is where your heart's going to be also. And that's written, by the way, in the context of money. You can't serve God and money. You'll either love the one and hate the other, hate the one and love the other. Where your treasure is where your heart will be also. That's the context of it. But the principle of it remains. The principle of that remains that wherever we invest our treasure, that's where our heart is going to be. So it's true financially, but it's also true emotionally. Where you invest your emotions, where you invest your treasure of your heart, that's where your heart's going to be. That's the words of Jesus there. And so I just encourage us to continually be vigilant and remember that affairs in marriage, they don't happen in an instant in most cases. It's usually over time. Started as just an innocent conversation, and then it progressively is like, well, man, she's really easy to talk to. And she understands me. And pretty soon there's more and more of that investment. And pretty soon the heart is there. And the actions are soon to follow. So be careful. Be careful that, like Herod, I speak to myself in all of this. Be careful that, like Herod, we don't end up regretting, living in that world of regret. I've been there before. I hate that. That world of, gosh, if I would have just responded to the Holy Spirit, if I would have just done what I knew God had me do, if I would have just responded, I wouldn't be in this situation. I wouldn't be, you know, in this guilt that I'm in or this regret that I'm in. If I had just responded. So husbands, invest in your wives. Wives, invest in your husbands. Single guys, listen, be careful not to invest in a gal emotionally that you have no intention of pursuing, because you'll end up breaking her heart. And the same is true vice versa. You know, be careful who we invest in. Saves a lot of brokenness, a lot of pain, a lot of suffering. If we choose to just say, you know, I'm gonna respond to the Holy Spirit, but I don't want to write what was written about Herod a few verses later of, I regret what I said, I regret what happened. Well, let's go on. Verse 12. Later, John's disciples came for the body, as you know, his head was taken. John's disciples were notified, it says, verse 12, that they came for his body and they buried it. Then they went and told Jesus what had happened. And as soon as Jesus heard the news, he left in a boat to a remote area to be alone. But the crowds heard where he was headed and followed on foot from many towns. And Jesus saw the huge crowd as he stepped from the boat, and he had compassion on them, and he healed their sick. Mark also explains this exact story. And in the Gospel of Mark, chapter 6, same story. The disciples of John the Baptist had disciples like Jesus had disciples, right? And so John the Baptist's disciples came to take the body and to bury the body. And then the word came to Jesus. And Jesus ended up getting in the boat And Mark tells the story like this. I want to read it out of Mark so we get a full context of what's happening here. Jesus said, hey, let's go off by ourselves to a quiet place and rest a while. With the news that we've just heard from John the Baptist's disciples, Jesus and his disciples, they were close. They were comrades. The disciples of John, the disciples of Jesus. And when they heard the news that John the Baptist had been killed, oh, the grief and the sorrow and the brokenness that took place in their life, and Jesus recognizing that says, hey, come on, let's go rest for a while. He uses a very specific word. Let's go to a quiet place, Mark chapter 6. You can note that and check it out later, 6:31. It says, let's go off by ourselves to a quiet place and rest a while. He said this because there were so many people coming and going that Jesus and his disciples didn't even have time to eat. So they were really busy. They got this word from John the Baptist's disciples. And so they left by boat for a quiet place where they could be alone. But many people recognized them and saw them leaving. And people from many towns ran alongside along the shore to get there ahead of them. And Jesus saw the huge crowd as he stepped from the boat. And he had compassion on them, because they were like sheep without a shepherd. So he began teaching them many things. And late in the afternoon, his disciples came to him and said, this is a remote place and it's getting late. In other words, Jesus, hey, come on. You said that we could get away, get alone, get some rest. It's getting late. And we're, you know, awful busy with all these people and we're getting tired and it's remote. And so why don't you send the crowds away so that they can go to nearby farms and villages and buy something to eat? In other words, would you get these people away from us so we can get some rest? Let them go get some food. And Jesus said in Mark chapter 6, verse 37, you feed them. You feed them. Same thing that Matthew records in Matthew chapter 14, you go feed them. And they answered, well, with what? And we've had to work for months to earn enough money to buy food for all these people. We'd have to work that long to buy food for all these people. And of course, the story goes on. But I love what happens here, because think about it for a second. Jesus knew that all those people were going to come around the other side of the lake. He knew when he said, hey guys, let's go rest a while. He knew that they were going to encounter this massive crowd. And when you and I think of rest, well, what comes to mind? Leisure, right? Been a long day, long week, long month, whatever. When we think of rest, we're like, man, I just need to shut down. I need to get a meal, and I just need to shut down, clear my schedule, have a little vacay. And there's a time for that. My goodness, of course there is. Highly encouraged. There's a time for that type of rest. But there's another kind of rest. And Jesus knew what he was saying to the disciples when he said, hey, guys, let's get away and rest a while. Come on, let's go. Back to Matthew chapter 14, verse 15. The disciples came to him and said, this is a remote place. It's already getting late. I'm cross-referencing the same story. Send the crowds away so we can go to the villages, or so they can go to the villages and buy food for themselves. But Jesus said, that's not necessarily, you feed them. So Matthew records the same thing. But we've only five loaves and of bread and two fish. And he said, bring them here. And then he told the people to sit down on the grass. And Jesus took the five loaves and the two fish, and he looked to heaven and he blessed them. And then, breaking the loaves into pieces, he gave the bread to who? The disciples, who distributed it to these 5,000. That's a lot of people. That's a lot of work. That doesn't feel like rest to me. You know, I would have been protesting at that point. Like, come on, man. You know, It was hard enough to row across the sea, you know, and we get here and we're like, you're talking rest, you're talking get refreshed. We get here and the first thing you do, Jesus, is you start just, you know, teaching. And we're, you know, like, man, we're tired, we're brokenhearted, we're grieving. John just died, for crying out loud. And let's just send him away. There's towns all around and they can just go back to town and get something to eat. And now you want to feed him. And then on top of that, you break all this bread that just keeps breaking and breaking and breaking. And then you say, you guys distribute it. Why don't we just make a buffet line and have everybody come through it or something? But you want us to go work more. I would have been in protest briefly, but I would have been. Maybe in my heart, but I would have been. And so they distributed. In verse 20, it says this, they all ate as much as they wanted, talking about the crowds. And afterwards, the disciples picked up 12 baskets of leftovers. Huh. 12 disciples, 12 baskets of leftovers. A basket of fish and bread for each one of them. About 5,000 were fed that day, in addition to all the women and children. These guys gave and gave and gave of what Jesus gave them, and you can never outgive God, ever. They had way more than they started with as they just set their hand to the kind of rest that I want to talk about here. See, I think a lot of times we think that, I think that somehow as I'm engaged in serving the Lord, that somehow that's going to deplete me of my energy and deplete me even more, right, of my resources. And it's, if I choose to serve the Lord, it's going to wear me out. If I give, if I serve, if I'm engaged, somehow that's going to drain on me. But I believe in this picture, Jesus is saying, no, actually, Jim, quite the opposite is what happens. When you serve, you find rest. You really do. And it doesn't make sense, just like giving doesn't make sense. Not in practical terms, but in spiritual terms, in miraculous terms, it does. Because God can't be outgiven. And so we engage in serving just like the disciples. Like, you know what? I'm gonna obey, I'm gonna give, and in return, I'm the beneficiary. I'm the one that's blessed. How many of you guys have experienced that? You know, you go to give, and who's the one that really is refreshed? We are. One of my favorite things to do that I don't get a chance to do as much as I would like is I love to go visit people in the hospital. It's one of my favorite ministry opportunities. I pull the old pastor card. Pastor Jim here to see so-and-so. Oh, come on in. You know. I guess I can do that because I'm a pastor, but whether it's in the ICU or the NICU with the families or wherever it may be, and just to go in and just, a lot of times, just be there. A lot of times it's not saying much. It's just being there. Praying for them. Talking to the family. Can I go get you guys a Subway sandwich or something? You know, just something. Can I just loving on them. And that always leads to just some really awesome conversation. And I drive home from that sometimes, you know, and all the way home, I'm just like, man, how do I get to be a Christian? How did that work out? Why do I get to be called by the name of the Lord? Why did he adopt me into his family? How rich am I? How rich am I to be able to just be alive, you know? And there's this, just something happens when we serve like that. And I believe that's what Jesus is really telling this. Because if you continue the story on, whether it's in Matthew or in Mark, they never go to what that place of leisure is that we might be thinking. Like, okay, well, maybe right after that, they ended up in the Bahamas or something, right? No, they never did. There was never this place of, all right, you know, we're checking into the Hilton or whatever, you know. It was never that. And they just went right on, you know. So what was that all about? Was Jesus just like, you know, yanking their chain? Going, hey, guys, get the boat. We're going to go get some rest, you know, and woohoo. And then it's like, all right, I got them in the boat, and now I've totally, you know, sabotaged them or whatever. No. He was saying in that whole picture, guys, I'm going to show you what rest looks like. And there's a time for the other. Jesus did that. He would get away. But there's a rest in service. And there's a happiness in serving one another. Remember at the Last Supper when they all came in, their feet were dirty, and they were having a meal together. Remember that? And they kind of bickered about who should wash each other's feet. And Jesus took the robe, and he disrobed himself. He put the towel around him, and he washed the feet of the disciples. Remember that story? And at the end of that story, he said, guys, I want to take a little break here from dinner, and I want to just kind of teach you something here. Did you notice what I did there? You know, I washed your feet, you know? And they're all like, yeah, our bad, sorry, you know? And he said, I'm going to give you a key to life. I mean, I'm going to give you a key to your whole existence. When you do that, you'll be happy. That's exactly what he said. He said, you've seen me, your master, wash feet. And that's good. That's good that you saw that. I'm glad that you guys are paying attention. I was washing your feet. So I'm glad you picked up on what happened there. But then he says this. Happy are you if you do this. Do what? Wash the feet of one another. Serve one another. That's where you're going to find it. No, I'm not. I'm going to find it in spending more money. I'm going to find it in a retirement or a car or a home or a better job or a raise. Nothing wrong with any of those. But Jesus said, you're going to find happiness in washing each other's feet, in serving each other. And I believe that he was showing them, guys, you're not going to only find happiness, you're going to find rest. You're going to find rest as you engage in feeding others. You yourself are going to be filled. As 12 baskets were left over, each disciple got one. They were filled. They were fulfilled. They were enriched. They were finding, wow, you know, there's something about this washing feet, serving thing that brings a fullness to my life that can't be found any other way. And that's exactly what I've experienced. And I pray that you would find that same truth worked out in your own life. I know you do. I shouldn't say I hope you do. I know you do. I know many of you that are choosing that lifestyle and finding, wow, you know what? You're right. That's where I find life. It's in serving. It's in giving. It's in being generous with my life and my resource and everything that I have. It's yeah, you're right, Lord. And it goes against the culture. It's certainly counterculture. But man, there's a richness there, and there's a fullness there. There's a fullness. And that's, I don't know how else to describe that. When my wife and I, over the years, have found ourselves just weary and tired, there's a time to get away. We got away 2 weeks ago. Thanks for letting us get away. We got away for a whole week. We were so stoked. We were going to go snowboarding in Tahoe. And as soon as we got down to Mount Shasta and turned to head towards Tahoe, the blizzard hit. And I don't know how long it took us to finally get to Tahoe. There was like, you know, snow all over the place and cars were all. And the whole time we were there, it was three blizzards in a row. And it was like, I don't know, 3.5 feet of snow fell in that week that we were there. And so we never got on the mountain. Never even. The gondola was just, you know, there's wind blowing everywhere and everything was shut down. And we just had a blast doing a bunch of nothing, you know. And there's a time to get away. And there's a time to just like, you know. I was kind of grumbling about it on the way back. Man, I can't believe I didn't get to, you know. And Maureen's like, yeah, but think of all the money we saved. I'm like, I don't care about heavenly. It's right back there. And it was, you know, and it was sunny on the way out, driving out. The sun was blue skies, you know, the day we came home. There's a time for that, for sure. But there's a time to be engaged. And I just encourage us, you know, stay in the game. You know, Maureen and I laugh about it a lot, but, you know, we're going to finish strong, whatever that means. You know, however long that is, we're just going to stay in the game. We're just going to finish strong. We're going to keep, you know, we're going to keep in it because we know this is where, this is what being about the kingdom of God is about. It's serving those that God has placed you to serve with, you know, or to serve. And it's not always within the context of the church. Yeah, we always need help around here, of course. You know, you always hear me whining about, we need more people for the kids. You know, maybe it's not whining, but yeah, it kind of is. But anyway, you hear that sometimes, you know, and that's good. It's our church. We need to take care of it, right? Of course. But it's not just that, you know. It's serving wherever you are. You know, it's giving out bread. The bread of life, you know, wherever you are, and you'll find yourself full. If you're feeling that emptiness, you know, if you're feeling like, man, I need to rest a while, and Jesus is calling you to that good, you know, decipher what kind of rest that is. You know, Lord, I just need to get alone and shut down and go for a walk in the woods for a couple of weeks or whatever. Great, you know. But sometimes that rest is just getting engaged in service in Jesus' name. Let's stand together. Lord, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the truth. And Lord, we have heard what your Spirit has spoken to us tonight. And Lord, we want to be responders to that. Perhaps, Lord, as we were talking about your Holy Spirit in our life, it's quickened some here to say, yeah, I need to respond to the Spirit. I need to move in the manifestations of God's Holy Spirit in my life. And it's been a while. Lord, I pray that that would be stirred up within. Maybe there are some here that just plain old physically need to get away and rest a while, literally, and just shut down. Perhaps, Lord, we haven't been engaged. And Lord, your word has prompted us to become engaged in washing one another's feet and engaged in giving out. Perhaps your word is spoken. And like Herod, we don't want to ever have to make that statement, I regret. We don't want to live in regret, Lord. And so whatever it is that your Holy Spirit has spoken to us tonight, Lord, we respond as an act of worship saying, yep, that's something I needed to hear by the word, and I'm going to respond to that tonight. Because look, again, Lord, we don't want to just be hearers of your word. We want to be doers. And so as we go our way, Lord, we go in response. When you say, you feed them, okay, Lord, we're in. And may we be the distributors of your grace and the distributors of the bread of life. May we be distributors of kindness and love in our workplace, in our communities, and in our own church family here. And we just commit to you, Lord, this time of worship in your word. You be blessed. You be honored in our life. Thank you for loving us, Lord, the way that you do, in Jesus' name. Really glad that you guys were able to join us via our live stream here at Mountain Church. I know that you were blessed because the Word of God is powerful. And hopefully I get a chance to meet you sometime. If you can make it down to any of our services, love to meet you. You can find out all of our services and what's going on around here at mtnchurch.tv. God bless you guys, and I hope to meet you soon.